Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to our worship service, both online and in person. Let us now, in silence, prepare our hearts to worship God. Our call to worship this morning is taken from Psalms 107, verses 1 to 4. O give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from trouble and gathered in from the lands, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, Almighty God, we thank you because you always does good things for us. You always faithfully love us to the very end. We, as people saved by your grace, want to declare your goodness and your love. Your goodness and love indeed have extended to people coming from the east and the west. You have also reached those from the north and the south. How great is your salvation to us! Praise your awesome name. You alone are worthy of our praise and worship, for you alone are the true and living God. We invite your mighty presence to fill your house this morning as we approach your throne to worship. Come and receive our adoration. Come and rule over us as our Lord and King. Be pleased with our worship this morning, for we pray all this in the precious name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us now invite the worship team to come and lead us into a time of meaningful worship.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So, finally, with some sun outside, why don't we all stand today, whether you're here in the sanctuary or at home, and let us sing some songs together to bring the presence of the Lord in.
Find me, all my fears and failures, fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Mighty to save, he is mighty. singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the won my heart. Jesus, you're all that I want. All that I want. 'Cause now until forever, Jesus, I surrender. Show me what I don't know, more of you. I'm desperate for your presence. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am in, the goodness of God.
I love your voice.
I love your voice. You have led me through the fire.
In darkest night,
you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend.
Goodness of God.
All my life you have been faithful.
All my life you have been so, so good.
With every breath that I am able,
I will
running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, is running after me. Your goodness is running after, is running after me.
Let us take some time to greet one another. Grace and peace to all of you who are worshiping with us online as well. It is indeed good to just meet one another. Let us continue our worship with our tithes and offering. Now the protocol will remain unchanged. There will be no collection of offering. Instead, please put your offering in the envelope provided and drop it into the Little Chapel offering box as you leave the sanctuary through the side door. For those who are worshiping with us online, you can either drop off your check in the church mailbox and call the church office to collect it, or you can mail it directly to the church address. Let us now reflect upon the words of 2 Corinthians 8:9 as we present our offering to God. 2 Corinthians 8:9 says, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you, by his poverty, might become rich." Let us pray. Father God, we come before you giving thanks for your wonderful, abundant provision in our life. We ask now, as we come before your throne, presenting our offering, we ask and pray that you will just accept our offering to the furtherance of your kingdom on earth. In Jesus' most precious name we pray. Amen. Now I refer you to the church bulletin for the announcement. First of all, a warmest welcome to all who are worshiping with us this morning, either in person or online. Do take note that face mask is now mandatory for all in-person services and gathering. And the number of worshippers is now capped at 65. Do take note of this. If you wish to attend the in-person services, you must pre-register by calling the church office or register online. The church theme for year 2022 is Start as One. The theme verse is taken from Philippians chapter 3, verses 13 to 14. The year 2022 elder board position is now out. The chairperson is Pastor Poon, and secretary is K.N. Eng, treasurer is Marky Tam, and the members at large are Daniel Shi, Thomas Chiu, and Michael Singh. The month of March in year 2022 has been designated as the Mission Awareness Month for our church. You can refer to the page on the right-hand side for all the schedule of all the planned events. And that is on the right page of the church bulletin. The mission department is delighted to learn together with all of us and be prepared for God's mission plan for our church. So do mark on your calendar and pray and participate in all the programs planned. More details will follow when it's closer to the date of the event. If you have questions, please do not hesitate to contact the mission deacon or the missions committee at mission@victoriacac.ca. A reminder is in order. All deacons and fellowship leaders, please remember to submit a ministry report for the year 2021 as soon as possible. Please continue to pray for the senior pastoral search, for the committee, and for the right candidate that God will bring to us. Oh, it came off earlier then. It's okay. Why you know this movie, right? It's The Avengers by Marvel. It was a story of a group of superheroes that banded together to battle an evil force that was bent on world domination. The only problem was these superheroes had a hard time working with each other. They were each caught up initially in their own agendas. They squabble. They talk maliciously about each other. They distrusted each other's motives. Consequently, for them, working on their own can actually be more productive than working together. And the bad guy was smart enough to anticipate all of this. He actually took advantage on the lack of unity in order to accomplish his evil plan. He almost won, because the Avengers failed to realize that it took all of them, each using his or her own gifts, in order to defeat their common enemy. The initial part of the movie described pretty much the way the church at Corinth was functioning, or malfunctioning. It all started with the spiritual gift the Christian have received for the benefit of the church community to fulfill God's purposes. Paul's instruction of this topic of spiritual gifts span over three chapters, from chapter 12 to chapter 14. However, in the present chapter, Paul wants to lay forth four fundamental principles regarding spiritual gifts and how it works out for the unity of the church. First, spiritual gifts point us to Jesus, verses 1 to 3. Let me read the passage to you, these three verses. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, you were led astray to mute idols, however you were led. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking in the Spirit of God ever says Jesus is a curse, and no one can say Jesus is Lord except in the Holy Spirit. Once again, we meet the familiar direction markers now concerning spiritual gifts. Indicates to us that the topic of discussion is on spiritual gifts. However, there is no quotation of the words or the specific requests of the complaining Corinthian Christians as before. So we have to assume that either they wanted Paul to comment, to just briefly or basically comment on it, or that Paul is taking the opportunity to exhort them on the topic. Paul continues, I do not want you to be uninformed. Other version uses the word ignorant. I do not want you to be ignorant. What about a spiritual gift? Does Paul not want the Corinthians to be uninformed or ignorant? First, Paul reminded them that in their former days, before becoming a Christian, they were led astray to mute idols. And they might have experienced the effects of evil spirits in their former pagan practices, in their former pagan life. Ecstatic utterances similar to the gift of speaking in tongues, healing the sick, and doing certain miracles had also been a part of the pagan religious background they were coming out of. They were worked themselves into a religious frenzy and be carried away or led astray in their worship of mute idols. And seemingly here, when they become Christian, these same believers also take pride in this spectacular sign gifts, and they consider them unique and of greater importance than the other spiritual gifts. We are not sure whether they have been actually given these spectacular gifts, but Paul gave them a twofold test of the presence of the Holy Spirit in the believer's life. First, the first test is that no person by the Holy Spirit can curse Jesus. And second, only by the Holy Spirit can a person openly testify that Jesus is Lord. Now, these two tests actually have been used by Christian exorcists, you know, to cast out demons. They would command the demons, you know, and if they can say out aloud that Jesus is Lord, then obviously it is not demon possession. Okay. If they cannot say it out aloud, that means it is motivated, you know, by evil spirit, because they will not be able to pass this test. In other words, if the gift does not point us to Jesus, it is not a gift of the Holy Spirit. Many years ago, when the charismatic movement emerges, someone asked the late theologian and scholar James Packer this question: how do I know whether the charismatics are from God? And Packer wisely answered, by their fruit. By their fruit. That's right. The believer in whom God's Spirit dwells joyfully confesses his loyalty or her loyalty to Jesus by acknowledging him as Lord in all of their lives and services. So if you find the fruit, this fruit present in a Christian, you can know that, you know, they are motivated, you know, and, you know, dwell upon, the Holy Spirit dwell upon them are from God and not from the evil source. Second, spiritual gifts are diverse, but the same triune God is the giver of them all. From verses 4 to 6. That says, now there are varieties of gifts by the same Spirit, and there are varieties of service by the same Lord, and there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who empowers them all in everyone. In verse 4, Paul picks up on the problem that the church faced, created by the seeming disparity in the nature of the gifts. Some of the gifts were quite spectacular, and those who possessed them had a tendency to be proud. Those gifts that were exercised in the context of worship, you know, for example, gave high visibility and prominence to those who possessed them. And it is easy to see, knowing the very human tendency to put ourselves forward, how these individuals might begin to think that they were more important than others. On the other hand, some of the members were given gifts that were exercised in less dramatic ways, in basically a servant role, for example. And it's easy to see how, because of the quiet and unseen way in which they did their part, they might wonder if their gift was important and if they were really needed in the church. Do take note, all gifts are needed in the church. Those who are serving on the pulpit, the worship team, the pastoral staff, when they stand upon here, they are merely leading you, the people of God, into a time of worship. And when the pastor, when the preacher stand behind this pulpit, he or she is standing on the authority of God's word and not on his own power or gifts. And the worship team, their main responsibility is not to gather applause from the congregation, but to lead them in worshiping God. The focus is not on themselves, but the focus is on worshiping God. Now, this is a continuing problem, even in the church today, which continues to try to make improper and invalid distinction concerning gifts. There is still a tendency to treat the gifts given to pastors and church leaders as being more important than the gifts given to the other church members. Consequently, we have those with more prominent gifts who are tempted to be proud, and God forbid that to happen to all those who are standing here serving God, you know, behind the pulpit or on stage. Consequently, we have those with more prominent gifts, as I mentioned, who are tempted to be proud, and those with gifts that seem less important, who may demean himself or herself. Do consider those who are serving behind the scene, those who are operating on the computer, those who are basically even serving tea, you know, and meals, you know, to the people, those who are cooking and preparing for it all. They are with those gifts that is very much needed, okay, for the church as well. There was another problem present here. There were those who despised their own gifts and coveted the gift of another. Paul's answer addresses all of this problem in a powerful and straightforward way. In the passage, if we momentarily suspend the repetition of the expression, there are varieties of, but the same, in order to focus attention on the nouns in these verses, we see the following arrangement. There are varieties of gifts, service, activities, but the same Spirit, the same Lord, the same God who empowers them all in everyone. While Paul celebrates the diversity of gifts, of activities, and of ministry or service, he insists that they had a common source and a common purpose from the triune God, the God three in one. All the gifts were from the Holy Spirit and for the purpose of building up the body of Christ. Paul makes this great liberating truth in these verses by insisting that every Christian is gifted by the triune God. Each one is given an ability by God's grace, and no believer is left out. Each gift is a manifestation of the Holy Spirit. Third, spiritual gift benefits the body of Christ, that is the church, from verses 7 to 11. Let us continue to read it. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. For to one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge, according to the same Spirit. Another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the ability to distinguish between spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. All these are empowered by one and the same Spirit who apportioned to each one individually as he wills. Do note the repetition of the word same. Same Lord, same God, same Spirit. Verse 7 tells us the purpose of spiritual gift. They are manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. What is the common good? 1 Peter 4:10 to 11 that says, as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good steward of God's varied grace. Whoever speaks as one who speaks oracles of God, and whoever serves as one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. And to him belong glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen to that. Right? 1 Peter 4:10 to 11 says that each of us should use whatever gift we have received in order to serve others. And later in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 3 to 4, which we will be looking at later weeks, Paul will say that those who prophesy speak to people for their upbuilding, encouragement, and consolation. And that one who prophesies builds up the church. Besides building up, encouraging, and consoling or comforting the body, spiritual gifts properly used grow the body of Christ, which is the church. Now let us look at 1 Corinthians 14, 24 to 25, and notice what happens when an unbeliever comes into a worship service. But if all prophesy and an unbeliever or outsider enters, he is convicted by all. He is called to account by all. The secrets of his heart are disclosed, and so falling on his face, he will worship God and declare that God is really among you. By the way, prophecy here in this context doesn't mean foretelling the future. It doesn't mean foretelling the future, but foretelling the word of God. Prophecy is the God-given ability to proclaim biblical truth in a way that brings people to a place of repentance and obedience. There are four places in the Bible where the spiritual gifts are listed. First, in Romans 12, 6 to 8. Second, in 1 Corinthians 12, those verses that we have read, verses 4 to 11, verses 28 to 30. We'll read that later on. And the third passage is in Ephesians 4, 11, and in 1 Peter 4, 10 to 11 that we have just read. Of all these places, there are different gifts listed in each one. However, there is not a comprehensive or exhaustive list anywhere found in the Bible. There isn't an exhaustive list of spiritual gifts. Hence, we can basically conclude that God never intended for us to get too hung up on identifying our own particular gifts. Nowhere in 1 Corinthians 12 to 14 did Paul encourage his readers to identify their gifts. Too often, I think Christians are hung up in trying to search for their spiritual gifts and forget about the actual serving, the actual service to God. Instead, Paul emphasizes that as the people walk in the fullness of the Spirit, they would automatically exercise their gifts to the benefit of others. Later in chapter 14, Paul also minimizes the benefit of speaking in tongues. Now, this doesn't mean that there isn't any value to this gift. But apparently, so much emphasis was given to it in Corinth that Paul feels the need to actually put it in perspective. Whether or not we know what our gifts are is not really that important. What really matters is that as we continue to walk in the Spirit, He will give us opportunities to work to benefit others, both inside and outside the church. And we will start to notice that certain kind of opportunities seem to come our way more frequently. They come easier to us. They feel like more of a natural fit. You know, in other words, spiritual gift inventories do not help us discover something about ourselves. About ourselves we were clueless about. They really just confirm what we already knew. We just didn't know the name for it, whatever gift we want to call it. Remember, if our gift does not benefit the body of Christ, which is the church, it is not a spiritual gift from God. And lastly, our fourth point, Spiritual gifts prove to be effective when coordinated to work like the human body. From the longest passage here in chapter 12, from verses 12 to 31. Paul now speaks about the church not as individuals, but as a unit. He portrays the church in terms of the human body, which in itself is among the most marvelous of God's creations. In this long passage, Paul addresses the problem of division in the church and makes a case for unity. The continuing need for the church with all its diversity is to find a basis for oneness, for unity. Paul has already argued for unity on the basis that all of our gifts have a common source, and that is the same, that is from the same triune God. But now he seeks to strengthen his position by the use of one of the most interesting of all analogies in saying to the church, you all are the body of Christ. We all together are the body of Christ. In verses 12 and 13, Paul lays down the only lasting basis of unity. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all were made to drink of one spirit. For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body. This is the only basis for being a member of the church. You know, it comes from the confession that Jesus is Lord. And it is regardless of racial, regardless of cultural, regardless of social, and regardless of sexual differences. Having established the picture of the church as a living body, Paul now draws some conclusion from that analogy in verses 14 to 20. I know that this passage is very familiar to all of us, but let us hear the word of God from verses 14 to 20. For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that will not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would be the sense of hearing? If the whole body were an ear, where would be the sense of smell? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, yet one body. Now, Paul uses a rational approach here that draws upon everyone's knowledge of the human body. He likens the different members of the congregation to the different parts of a human body, and shows in this way both its great diversity and its essential unity. The picture of a foot, you know, withdrawing from the body because it cannot be a hand, or an ear resigning from the body if it cannot be an eye, is so ridiculous that it is funny. Right? The picture of a body made up of nothing but eyes, or nothing but ears, is amusingly foolish. The idea of the eye discussing with the hand that is not being needed, or the head, you know, telling the feet you are not needed, simply intensifies the foolishness. What Paul is describing are things that would never happen in the physical body. But that were happening in the body of Christ, which is the church. It will never happen in the human body, but it actually happened in the physical church. Think about that analogy. Several important truths found in this analogy can be helpful to us today as we think about our relationship with the church. Let me continue to read from verses 21 to 26. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And on those parts of the body that we think less honorable as we bestow the greater honor, and our unpresentable parts are treated with greater modesty, which our more presentable parts do not require. But God has so composed the body, giving greater honor to the part that lack it, that there may be no division in the body, but that the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. First, while we are not the same, each of us is important to the whole. Paul reminds us that in the body, a part that may seem to be weaker or less honorable may actually have a more important function than first thought. All of us have seen examples of this in the physical body. Now, there was a student who had been destined to be one of the great fullbacks in college football. During his high school years, because of the combination of size, speed, and agility, he had broken all sorts of records and had been highly recruited by the major universities. Then, on a summer job in a lumber camp, a job he had taken as much for the training aspect as for the income, he lost a part of his big toe in a freak accident, and it ended his career as an athlete. What he discovered was that the loss of his big toe lost him his fast starts and his agility. The church, you know, actually has a lot of big toes that are just taken for granted. We must be careful lest we forget how important they really are to the church. Second, we desperately need each other. The fact that the different parts of the body need each other is obvious. But what is obvious for our body is not so apparent within the church. There is something in us that tries to make the Christian life a lone ranger kind of experience. I think most of us actually, or not actually most of us, you know, would know the, you know, the older guys, right? Would know this drama series, The Lone Ranger, right? And, there is something in us that tries to make the Christian life a Lone Ranger kind of experience, you know. But there is no such thing as isolation in the church. All the picture, or beside COVID-19 isolation, by the way, all of the picture of the church are group pictures. The more mature we become in Christ, the more we realize that throughout our entire life, we will continue to need each other. We complement each other. We challenge each other. We comfort each other. And we communicate with each other. Within this context, we find our Christian identity, our ministry to one another, our growth, and our support for one another. The church is the place where each of us is needed, and each of us brings needs. This is what we all have in common, and it gives us a basis for our unity. Finally, in the body, what affects one member is actually felt by all. One of the great insights into the nature of the church is shown in Paul's reflection that if one member suffers, all suffer together. And also, if one member is honored, all rejoice together. This happens automatically in the body. An infection in the hand spreads and the whole system feels the impact. Then Paul concludes his chapter by returning to a discussion on membership in the church and on the gifts that God grants to the members. Reading from verse 27. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healing, helping, administrating, and various kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? But earnestly desire the higher gift, and I will show you a still more excellent way. With that, actually, Paul concludes with a cliffhanger. And stay tuned for the next sermon, right? You may know the answer. The least mentioned evidently is different from the one mentioned in verses 8 to 10 of the same chapter. Paul makes it a point to rank this spiritual gift by priority. For him, the gifts of speaking with tongues and interpreting them are the last on the list. With that, Paul is playing down this spectacular gift or sign gifts that the Christian take pride in, and they wear it as badges of superiority before other brothers and sisters. You know, I can speak in tongues, you know. I am more superior than you. This is a contributing factor to the division existing in the church. Then Paul closes the chapter by exhorting them to earnestly desire the higher gifts in the list that would certainly promote unity. Now, back to the Avengers. What finally brought this group of dysfunctional heroes together was the death of one of the characters. Somebody gave his life for the sake of the group, and this is what brought them together. At the end of the day, the one thing that makes a church more than just a bunch of talented people is the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Everything we do points to the sacrifice Christ made for us and the reality of his resurrection. Without that, we could still be a group of talented people. But because of the resurrection and the power of Christ that works within us, we are gifted people brought together into one body for one purpose. And that is to glorify God with our lives and bring glory to Him and share His message to the world. The body of Christ must be coordinated to be effective in serving God. Let us put our church team into action. start as one. Then let us not just talk about it, you know. We've been talking about it in the previous year. Now we are talking about it again. Let us just put into action. Let us really start as one. May God help us. May God help all of us to realize the potential, the gifting that He has given us and use it for His glory as one body. Let us truly start as one. Let us pray. Father Lord, we come humbly before You. We come as sinners saved by Your grace. We come with thanksgiving, with gratefulness that You have given us varieties of gifts so that we can use it together as one body to give glory to You as one body for the unity of the church. We ask, God, that You will truly come and help us to be that united body, to serve You together as one body of Christ. Help us, O Lord, as we commit ourselves to this task. Help us truly to start as one. We pray all this in the precious name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Feng, for the message. And as we rise to sing the final song in response, I don't know if you guys also noticed, but there's another word used a lot during this sermon. That was the word all. And I find that it's so difficult to use the word all sometimes because when we talk to people, not everyone is in conjunction with each other. So when you use the word all sometimes, it only really pertains to one person or two people. But as a church, we all have something in common as well, and we all are sinners, and we all were saved by Jesus Christ dying on that cross. And like this chorus says, through it all, my eyes are on You, and through it all is well, and it is well. So as a church, let us look at this theme this year, start as one, continue to get closer as a body of Christ in this church. So let's stand and sing this final song.
It is well.
Receive the benediction. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Be seated, please. After a moment of silent prayer and meditation, you may be dismissed.